Harvinder Singh Phoolka, 3rd of February 2014. In June 1984, I was in Delhi. I was 28 years plus. I was a lawyer practicing in Delhi. In the first week of June, my wife was to attend a conference at Mysore. So we had a waiting list on the in the train. We had made the reservation, but we were on the waiting list. I was not feeling well. I had a fever. We went to the railway station and our seat was not confirmed. But we went to the railway station. This was on the 3rd June. And we saw the trains to Punjab were cancelled. And they said the train to Punjab were cancelled. The people were on the platform. No trains were going. And then on 4th June, we took the flight and went to Bangalore. And from where they, we went to Mysore. Now on 6th June morning, one of my wife's student, Dr. Shah from Kashmir, he came and knocked at our door. He said, Phoolka sahab, uthiye, kya ho gaya, kya ho gaya? And he said that Golden Temple is attacked. I mean, he was so disturbed to know this. And he said, look at this, what they have done. So when we came back from Mysore, I went to meet my relations. This was in June, last week, around 3rd week of June, to Jalandhar. And I was told that Harvinder Sahib is opened. The previous day, they allowed some devotees to go in. So the next very day, early morning bus I took, me and my wife's cousin, and we reached Harvinder Sahib early morning. So it was, I mean, all army everywhere. It was like a put army camp. Everywhere the army was there. And they took us inside. I mean, in the Parkarmaya also everywhere, army standing. And we saw the Akal Takht Sahib in that state, totally broken. And among the devotees, no one was allowed to even peep into the Parkarmaya's rooms. Not at all. And we went to the Parkarmaya, went to Harvinder Sahib. Harvinder Sahib was not damaged inside. After that, when we came out, nobody was allowed to even stand, even for a minute, throughout. And so that was only 2 days. That day when they realized that what is happening, the people used to stand in front of Akal Takht and cry. They closed it again. They closed it again. So that is the memory of 84. Then after that, when the Tarkunde report came, Justice Tarkunde has given a report on Golden Temple attack, Blue Star. When the Tarkunde report came and the government banned the report, this was in September, October 84, they arrested all the members, Pancholi, Huja, and them. When I learnt about it, so I immediately reached the Tisdari court where these people were to be produced. So I was there to appear to handle their case. So I was very junior, as I told you, only to stand there for so that I could at least offer my services. And so the M.A.R. House warrants were issued, an old lady of 80 years, a renowned social worker. What was troubling the government, because in that report, they had annexed a post-mortem report where the doctor said the body is brought on the table for post-mortem, the hands are tied behind, and the killing is by shorting the fats. So that means the people were shot after that hands were tied behind. And they didn't have the time even to open the hand. So they took that. So that doctor gave the report. So this is the first document with the government propaganda. It was all militants. It was this. They were all. This is the first report which they came. This is the innocents were killed. This is the manner the innocents were killed. So the government immediately they even went for Tarkundi to arrest him. There was a lot of hue and cry. The only one political leader who stood with us was Chandrasekhar. Otherwise, everybody has turned against. That was the atmosphere at that time. So, and then this All India Sectional Federation was banned. So I, along with one or two other advocates, we said, we will appear for them. Tell us where to go. So I didn't happen to do the case much, but I offered my services. Soon thereafter this, November happened. In November 1984 also, I was in Delhi. That by that time, I was 29 years. And on 31st October, in the morning, I went to the court as usual. And in the court, the news reached and the lords were talking about that Mrs. Gandhi has been shot. Little after that, the news came that she has been shot by her own security guards. And so there was, everybody was talking about it. And hardly any cases were not being done. Mostly the lords were busy talking about this thing only. And then the news came that she's been shot by security guards whose name is Singh. Till that time it was not sure whether they were Sikhs. Little after that, by about noontime, the news started coming on the radio that they were the Sikh security guards who have shot her. Around noontime, say about 1 or 2 o'clock afternoon, early afternoon, the news came that she is no more. What the official declaration, what not there. But somebody came and said that the spot news outside the Hindustan Times is that she is no more. I was there till the afternoon. And in the court, mostly the matters were being adjourned. Not much work was done. And in the afternoon, around 3:30, 4 o'clock, I went to my wife's office, which was in Narayana, which is about half an hour from the court. I thought that probably her office would also be closed because of the reason, this incident. So I landed up there by about 4:30, but they say no office will close at the normal time, 5:30. So everything was going on normally as far as there. So I waited around close to that in the market for about 1 hour. 5:30, I picked her up. I went to my office in Connaught Place, and when I reached my office, the office boy told me that two of my friends who had come from Ludhiana, that they were staying with us at my home. They say they have left and they'll pick up the luggage from your house and will go back to Punjab today. So we got worried. So I was telling my wife that the roads will not be safe. Because Haryana earlier also the incident has happened. About 6-7 months before that, in February 84, some bus killings took place in Muksar and the Sikhs were taken out and beaten in Panipat. I say that again the same thing may happen in Haryana. Roads are not safe, so they shouldn't leave Delhi. They should stay in Delhi. Delhi will be safe. I told my wife, close the office and let's go and try to stop them. So we were going home. I had a mobile. And when we reached the Rajpath area, now the Rajpath is the main center of power in Delhi, which is between President House and the India Gate. This is the place where the Republic Day Parade goes. At that crossing red light, one car came from the other side and he waved and asked me to stop. And now this was a Hindu gentleman. And so I told my wife, ke, koi rok raha hai, maybe somebody known to us. So I stopped my bike and that gentleman came and said, ke, Sardar ji, aage mat jao. Aage aale crossing pe sardaron ko maar rahe hain. Jahan bhaag sakte ho, bhaag jao. Now, later on, I came to know that on the next very crossing, which is the Lutyens Delhi, which is a VVIP area of Delhi, at that time, the full-scale violence was going on there. It was, by that time, it was about 6:37 p.m. And the Sikhs were being beaten up, the cars were being burnt. So I immediately took a turn and I went from the other road. That other road is from Lodhi State to Kotla. That time I had my house in South Extension. We were the tenants there. And so I took that route. When we took that route, there was unusually heavy traffic on that because traffic was diverted. We passed by Kotla Mubarakpur village and we reached home. Our landlord was standing outside. By that time it was dark. And they were shocked and surprised that how you have reached here. They say from all sides there are already everything is burning. They are beating the Sikhs. They say we were trying to get in touch with you and tell you that don't come here. I say I've come from Kotla side. They say Kotla side, look back. When we looked back, the Gurdwara, which we had passed in front of the Gurdwara, that Gurdwara was in flames. So I do not know how we crossed that Gurdwara unnoticed. The mob was already at that time at Gurdwara. Now on 31st October, the violence was mainly centered around this area. South Extension is about a kilometer from Ames Hospital. The body of Mrs. Gandhi was kept at Ames. And in the evening, by about 6 p.m. or so, it was taken out from there and taken to Teen Murthy House. Later on now, when I was filling up the affidavits of Mishra Commission in 1985, that is the time I came to know the complete sequence of events. The first attack of any Sikh which took place in Delhi was around 4:35, and this was on the President of India. President of India's car was attacked. His press secretary's car's window panes were broken. President's own car's window panes were broken. So President went to the Ames where Mrs. Gandhi's body was lying. After some time he came out, and after 15-20 minutes he came out. The second time again the attack took place. Again he was attacked. Though his bodyguard, which was escorting, his turban was taken off and he had severe head injuries. Now, after that, the violence spread from Ames. The mob went on all four sides from Ames. Now, we have tracked the record of the fire brigade. With the timings corroborated, we draw the map of that area, and the mob starting from that Ames crossing goes to all four sides. From the timings of the fire brigade, we have related it to show that how it was organized. It was not the people spontaneously who started, but it was from that place. The Congress leaders were present, the whole Congress central leadership was present there. And from there it was started, that affidavits has come, evidence has come by Arjun Das, the Congress counselor, and his brother. So this, since this area, South Extension, was very close, so all over around the South Extension also, the violence was going on, the shops were burned, cars were being burned. That is what's happening. So on 1st November, we remained home the whole day. Nothing much untoward happened on the 1st November. But I didn't even have the phone. We were on the first floor. My landlords were on the ground floor. So I came to ground floor and I called up my uncle. He is a very rich man of Delhi. And he had a palatial house near Connaught Place, about 2 acres house at that time. And I had stayed in that house when I came to Delhi for 2 years. So I called up uncle. I said that please try to take us out of here because this area is prone to violence. And he said, roads are not safe. Even we are not safe. Be where you are. Don't try to come out. Then I called up some of my other friends. Everybody says, all over on the roads, the killings is going on. Don't come out. So that day somehow passed. That time, I was married just about a year back. My wife was on a family way. And on 2nd November morning, our house was attacked. The next house to ours was a new house built by a Sikh transporter. And it was a beautiful house. Their target was that house. They first attacked that house and they set it on fire. Then they attacked our house. And it was apparently, because I was a tenant, hardly anybody knew me. The person who used to give the milk at our home, he told the mob that a Sikh lives here also. So the mob attacked our house. Our landlord said, no, he has already left, he has gone to Punjab, he is not here. Our landlord shifted us from there on the second floor. Their other son was living and his wife was a French woman. So she took us to her house and she hid us in the loft along with the beds and the quilts. And she put some quilts in front of us and locked the door of that loft. And it was at about 4-5 feet high. It was very difficult for my wife even to climb. But there was no option. So we were there for almost the whole day. Once the mob even came up looking for us. But they didn't find us, so they thought probably the landlord is right. We also saw that the landlord also brought that Sikh family on the adjoining house, a transporter, to their house from the back door. And they hit them also. They hit them in one of the rooms in the ground floor. Then fortunately, one of the persons whose house was the next to that Sikh transporter's house, he had a garment factory. He thought if this house is burnt, my factory will also burn. He went to the main road and an army truck was passing by. He brought that army truck. And when the army truck came, they evacuated that Sikh transporter, our neighbors. And it was about to leave when that landlord said, call them also, let them also leave. Otherwise, they are not safe. So I and my wife, we ran. I was without shoes, without even a turban, just a small dastar. And similarly, my wife, we ran and I saw a Sikh army man. And I saw how his eyes were burning. I don't know how he controlled himself. We were evacuated from there. My wife couldn't even climb the army truck. Then a landlord's son came. He said, okay, you come up, sit in my car. We will go along with it. So he took us to the All India Medical Institute campus. His sister was a doctor and brother-in-law was a doctor there. So he took us to their house. At their house, we were there and they say, if the mob comes to know you are here, they attack our house. So they say, if you cut your hair, otherwise we are in problem. So at that time, I called one of my friends. He was a pilot in Indian Airlines. And his cousin was a commando of the BSF. He was in charge, commandant of the BSF commandos. So I called him up. I said, you bring your cousin and come with the commanders and take me out of here. So after some time, after about 1 hour, that friend of mine, Captain Gary, Devinder Singh Gary, he's a Rajput, but from Punjab. And another friend of mine, Captain Amar Singh Malli, he's a Kat Sardar. They both came, but there were no commanders with them. They said, nobody is prepared to move, but don't worry, we are there. They will first have to attack us before they could attack you. So they had come prepared. Gary had a master car. So they had come with the quilts, rajais, blankets. So they made me lie down on the back seat. In fact, between the both the seats. And put the quilts on that. And my wife was sitting. And on the while coming back, he has surveyed the area that where the mob is not there. So when we went and then wherever he saw the mob, he increased the speed of the car and just crossed through them. And that's how he took us to his house in Saket. Gary was on the flight on 1st November. House behind them was a newly constructed house by an army officer. And Gary's wife always used to tell us, what a beautiful house. They have beautiful cutlery. They have beautiful furniture. When we reached there, that house was reduced into ashes. And Gary said that I am repenting. Why did I go on a flight? If I were here, I wouldn't have allowed them to do this. And when their house was attacked, Gary's wife brought them to their house and then they were sent away. Second night, Gary went out. He's a very well-built. He put his overcoat and picked up a big stick, a dung, and he went out on the streets. And he said, I will see now who attacks any house in my street. And he gathered two or three other persons and he was patrolling. On the last house in the street, there was a mob. They were looting the house. So he picked up the people and threw them out. But more people came. Then he saw an army jeep going. He stopped that army jeep. He tells that lieutenant, open the fire. He said, I don't have the orders. He said, forget about you are an army man. What kind of army man is there? This is happening. What orders do you need than this? He said, fire. That lieutenant started firing. When he fired just two shots in the air, the whole mob ran away. After that, nobody came in that road. But at the same time, even Gary's wife was so much scared. Even the servants in the house didn't know that we are in the house. Whenever any servants used to come in the house, we were locked in the bedroom. This was the state of affairs. In whole of Delhi, not even single place where the Sikh could feel secure. On 5th November, Gary told the airline that you assigned me the duty of Chandigarh flight. So he took us in the airline car to the airport. And airport, when we saw the state of affairs, the Sikh families, very, very rich Sikh families, they are lying there on the airport, waiting for the flight to Punjab. And the flights are all full. Garrett goes and tells that I have two friends and I want to take them. I'll buy the tickets. That girl in the said, we don't have any seat. He said, seat, no seat. They will go with me. And he said, there's one supernumerary seat for a pilot. They will be there. She says, not loud. He says, loud, what's happening in the city? He said, you will have to accommodate them. He made us sit in the cockpit and took us to Chandigarh and dropped us there. That time, my whole family, not only that time, even still, my family as well as my wife's family, they are in Punjab. We were the only one in Delhi, except my uncle. No one else was related to us was in Delhi. So when we reached Punjab, there was a lot of pressure on us from my in-laws as well as from my own family that why don't you come back? I had got married in November 83. My wife is a PhD and she was teaching in Ludhiana in Punjab Agricultural University. And so we thought that she'll take up the job back and at least we will have something for livelihood. So we went to even talk to her professor also in Ludhiana, as she'll take out the job and slowly, slowly I will also start practice. And so around 20th November, 2021, so we decided to come back to Delhi so that we wrap up everything and take our luggage and go back to Punjab. We came by air. And when we reached in Delhi and 2nd or 3rd day only, I was in the court when I was told that the lawyers are needed in the relief camps. So I was that time boiling with anger. What to do? I said, yes, I will go to the camps. Tell me. So one lawyer sent me to the office of chamber of Mr. Hardev Singh. He was a senior advocate. So I said, tell me where to go. He say a group of journalists and professors have formed one organization called Nagrik Ekta Manch. So they are the one who is looking after the leaf camps. So you go there. So I was sent to the leaf camps of Farsh Bazar. Farsh Bazar is the area. There I was sent to the leaf camp. Now the Trilokpuri victims were there. There was hardly a male member in that family, in that any family. All women and children, all male members were killed. And when I went and saw the status there, there's nobody to write their complaints because those professors and students, and they don't know how to write the complaints. There's nobody to fill up their affidavits. So this was the state of affairs. Nobody was there to guide. So I I told them how to, what pattern to do, how to go about it. And from there, my this connection started. And in fact, when I came back that evening, and I discussed with my wife, I said, now you see, I mean, there is such a dire necessity of the lawyers. And there are so many sick lawyers. Nobody is going forward. I say, if we leave now, I'll feel guilty throughout my life. So let's stay back for some time. Let's do at least this much. And I'll be able to take out my anger this way. And she say, I'm with you. So that's the time we decided to stay back. So I started going to relief camps. In the first week of December, I did the first case of 84. They were orphan girls. Four sisters, they all were minors. They were sent to Nariniketan, a children home. Their grandfather came from Rajasthan for their custody. And those girls, father, mother, brother, uncle, everybody was killed, only minor girls were left. That was the first case which I did in first week of December, 84. So from there, I started doing these cases. So when I started my practice in 1981. I had only 3 years experience that time. Now 3 years experience is no time for a lawyer. But it so happened that I started with, whenever I used to hear there is some case pending, I used to go and stand behind the lawyer handling the case. Because most of these cases, there were very, very few cases. Govinda Mukhote, senior advocate, or Hardeep Singh, senior advocate, they were the one who were doing some of these matters. And I used to just go and stand behind them, sir, may I help you? And if he gives me a slip, get me this book from the library, go running to the library, get a book and be happy that I have done my bit. That is what I told in one of the schools when I was giving a lecture. Ke main to kitab padhan gaya si, mainu nahi si pata ke ਬਾਬੇ ਨੇ ਮੇਰਾ ਹੱਥ ਫੜ ਕੇ ਉੱਥੇ ਬਿਠਾ ਲਿਆ ਕਿ ਆ ਲੈ ਤੂੰ ਹੀ ਕਰਨਾ ਆਈ ਹੈਡ ਐਬਸੋਲੂਟਲੀ ਨੋ ਆਈਡੀਆ ਐਂਡ ਆਈ ਹੈਡ ਐਬਸੋਲੂਟਲੀ ਨੋ ਇੰਟੈਂਸ਼ਨ ਆਫ ਪਲੇਇੰਗ ਅਪ ਸੱਚ ਏ ਬਿਗ ਰੋਲ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਮਾਈ ਸਟੈਂਡਿੰਗ ਐਟ ਦਾ ਬਾਰ ਵਾਜ਼ ਨੋਟ ਐਟ ਆਲ ਆਫ ਦੈਟ ਲੈਵਲ ਦੈਟ ਆਈ ਕੁਡ ਪਲੇ ਐਨੀ ਬਿਗ ਰੋਲ ਬਟ ਇਟ ਸੋ ਹੈਪਨਡ ਦੈਟ ਵੈਨ ਦਾ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਟਾਕਡ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਅਪੁਆਇੰਟਮੈਂਟ ਆਫ ਮਿਸ਼ਰਾ ਕਮਿਸ਼ਨ So I was the one who went to each and every quarter that we have to form a one organization. We all have to unite against the government. I went to Khushwant Singh, I went to General Roda, I went to Justin Rola, I went to Hardeep Singh. I was the one. I didn't know any one of them, but I used to just walk into somebody's office. We need to unite. We need to unite. And as a result of that, an organization of umbrella organization, all human rights groups, PJCL, PJDR, Citizen for Democracy, they all, Solis Ravji, General Roda, Khushwant Singh, a committee was formed called Citizen Justice Committee. And Justice S.M. Sikri, the former Chief Justice of India, he became the president of this. And Tarkunde Surabji, all were the members. And they were trying to find somebody to be the secretary of this. So they were looking for some IAS officer, some IPS officer. But in the meantime, they asked me that you take care of, look after the work. And in the next meeting, when they say that we have not formed anybody good, So he said, this young boy is doing a very good job, let him be the secretary of the organization. So this was in July 1985, means such a powerful committee, umbrella organization of all the human rights groups of India. I became the secretary of that. And then I was made in charge of filing all the affidavits before the Vishak Mission. So this, everything fell upon me. So 2 years, I left my practice and I was whole time into it. Whole time into it. And Solis Rabji, senior advocate, now he's been the attorney general of India twice and very busy advocate during those days, but he had given instructions to his staff that whenever Phoolka comes, don't make him wait. Bring him straight inside. I mean, that is the kind of thing. It was these people who, in fact, did a lot. And in fact, if I say that if I have been able to do it, and if I have survived even after doing all this, these cases, taking these all Pagal, Titler, head on, during those days, it is because of the backing of these people. That's where I am. You see, disillusionment was always there. But there were failures, I would call it. But every failure used to infuse more energy. More energy. We will have to do this. We'll have to one day succeed. Those failures did not frustrate me. There were once or twice, there were times when I was quite disturbed and disillusioned. But soon thereafter, I could pick up. So, once time was when Vishak Mission report came in 1987. That was the time when we thought we had lost all the hopes. So it was a difficult period from 87 till 2000. Till 1990, we thought that nothing is going to happen. At the time, few journalists, they said we have to keep this issue alive. So, Manoj Mitta, there was one, Rajiv in Hindustan Times, Sanjay Suri in Indian Express. So they say we will manage in such a way that after every month or two, one or the other story should need to come in some newspaper. So that is how they managed. That we have to keep the issue alive. Meantime, the BP Singh government came in power, Congress was defeated. So immediately this issue being picked up. The second time when I was quite disillusioned, in 1990, my wife had gone for a postdoctorate into US. This was on a US government fellowship. And she got outstanding graduate award and she was offered some jobs, good jobs, very good jobs. And so she asked me, I say, now the VP Singh government has come, the cases have started, I can't leave. This will be over within two, three years. So you take up the job, I'll join you later. She said, why? Why we need to be there? Forget about it. We don't need America. We live in India only. So she left it and came back to India. In 93, we came to know about the problem of my son. He's a special child. He's born in 89, till about 93, we didn't know his problem. And that time, there was absolutely no facility in India. That was a big, big, and in fact, disillusionment. A big disillusionment. That is the time we repented. That why we were, if we were in the USA, probably he would have been better off. And, but anyhow, I was able to come across this also very soon. Because soon thereafter, Madanlal Khurana government came in power. And Madanlal is the one leader who was sincerely, to the core, interested in pressuring the country. I don't remember even a single occasion when I had told Madanlal Khurana, this is to be done, and he has not done it. Even if on the phone I tell them, sir, ye karna hai, hone lao. Even if it's within his power or not his power, he'll immediately get up and start. That was sincere to the core on this issue. Unfortunately, Khurana remained chief minister for a very short period. And, but that was main factor. And now the second time I am finding is the same sincerity in Kejriwal. The same kind. In between, I have not found that much sincerity and dedication in any leader. You see, it has a lot of impact on my life. There's absolutely no doubt about it. But one thing I should say, I mean, in one corner of my mind, there was always to do something for the society. When I was in my law college at Punjab University, so I was known for this thing, that I want to do something against the tide. I was known for it. So it has changed the course of my life, definitely. But I think that desire to do something, and if I should say, this feeling I got it from during my days in Punjab Agricultural University. And that is what, in fact, probably convinced me to do all that what I did. And whenever everybody used to, even my family was totally supported me. My family had totally supported me. And whenever anyone used to say the threat, what is the threat you are going, I always used to say, I mean, God saved my life twice, one on 31st October night, then on 2nd November. What more threat? What more danger? What more danger than that? If he has saved me then he'll save me now also. So I never bought it. I was offered security in 1985 by Mishra Kushan. He said, the whole, my proceedings are dependent on you. If something happens on you, I said, I'll not accept security. He said, I have already ordered the police commissioner. I said, no, I will not. He said, why? I said, the day I start with the gun-toting policeman, this case will fall. He said, why? Like, how can I go and tell these widows, have courage, if the policeman with stained guns are standing behind me? I said, no, I'll not do that. And this was the only strength, now I tell you. I mean, these people were shaken. All this Pagas sergeant title. I mean, now Pagas was so powerful in Delhi at that time. Even the Prime Minister today and Chief Minister together are not that powerful as Pagas was. I mean, this is what they were worried about. What is this man? When I used to go all alone on the motorcycle, going, I said, karo kya karte ho? I mean, that is the... I mean, until today, after that, again, I was offered security after that fight with Titler when he threatened me. I said, no, I will not. I said, my security is mera vagro. You see, there's a deep hurt. And I feel that hurt need to go out. And this can only go out if you start working for it. I mean, it hurt should not poison your mind. You should do something. You should work something. Do something for it. I mean, like I took out my anger by doing these cases. Some other people may take out their anger by helping the victims. Some other may take out their anger by spreading the message. Now, if I tell you, it is not only that I am doing the cases of the six, it's wrong. When anybody says, I am doing the cases of the six, no. I have somehow emerged as a face against the criminal violence in India. And that is the reason in my book, I have criticized Rajiv Gandhi and I have criticized Modi even more for Gujarat. So that is how I look at it. I said, the first principle Guru Nanak has taught us, ek noor se sab jako priya, and sarvata pala, we have to stand by it. And I tell you, I was the one who was so hurt with the killing of the innocents in Punjab. And I have no hesitation in saying so. Those days I went to General Roda, I said, we have to give the statement. And we issued the statement, no innocent should be killed wherever they are. I went to Professor Darshan Singh. He was the Jassiyar of Kaltax. Mecca, for God's sake, please stop it. This is against the basic principles of Sikhism. Let them fight their battle with the police, but not with these people. We're taking out the people from the buses and killing it. And Professor Darshan Singh tells me, they are not the Sikhs who are doing it. I said, then say so. That no Sikh can do it. I said, the day you fall from this basic principle of Guru Nanak, that will be the worst day for the Sikh. That's how I am.